I'm David Somerville, pastor of Southside Southern Baptist Church in Parkersburg, West Virginia. I'm glad you've joined with us again today for this message. We usually meet together at 2004 Guyon Road in Parkersburg. Hopefully we'll be meeting together again there soon. So if you're joining with us by Facebook or by YouTube, and if you like this, click the like button or thumbs up, whatever it may have there. And if you feel led to, I invite you to share this with other people as well. And let us know what you think of these. If there's certain things that we could do that would be more helpful or if they improve on, please let me know. And I do want to say a big thank you to my wife, Lynn. She is the one who puts these together and plugs in the hymns and the scripture verses and makes me look good. So I want to say thank you to her. So even though we're not able to meet together at the church building, this is the way that we're going to be doing it for the next at least couple of weeks more. We're also doing a Sunday school class on Zoom, using that Zoom platform. So if you're interested in that, please contact the church office at the information at the end of this message. So let's begin with a word of prayer as we approach God's word. Father, we do thank you for your word, how it is holy, it is perfect, it is living and active and able to speak to our hearts today. So I pray you would speak to us through your word as we look at it today and help us to be more like Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But then things change and you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, for you're never alone. For the God on the mountain, he's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God in the good times, he's still God in the bad times. The God of the day, he's still God in the night. Oh, we talk of faith when we're up on the mountain, but the talk comes easy when life's at its best. It's down in those valleys of trials and temptations. Don't lose faith, for you're never alone. For the God on the mountain, he's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God in the good times, he's still God in the bad times. Oh, the God of the day, he's still God in the night. Yes, the God of the day, he's still God in the night.
Well, I invite you to take your Bibles and turn to Proverbs chapter 13. Proverbs, Psalm, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, in that part of the Old Testament. This story from World War I, way over 100 years ago, about a man who was venturing on a journey, and he was in this treeless, desolate valley in the French Alps. He runs out of water there, and he's in a pretty difficult situation. And this war-torn area, there in this valley that just had crumbling buildings. There's no trace of civilization at all, anyone living there. But he is rescued by a middle-aged shepherd. The name of the shepherd's name is Elziard Bouffier. And Elziard takes the man to a spring and gets him some water, and then invites him to spend the night in his small hut there in that valley. After dinner, when they were in the shepherd's hut there, the stranger watched this shepherd meticulously sort through a pile of acorns, in which he would discard those that were cracked or undersized. And then when the shepherd had counted out 100 perfect acorns, he stopped for the night and went to bed. Well, the next day, the stranger observed this shepherd as he led his sheep along the way. Every so often, he would stop with his staff, and he would jab that staff into the ground, wiggle it around a little bit, and drop an acorn in that hole that he had made there. And he passed on, just did that without even commenting on it or drawing attention to it. Well, many years after the war had ended, this stranger returned to that same area, and he was surprised to see young saplings of all forms taking root and springing up from this once treeless area, this desolate area. It was full of greenery now. The authorities couldn't figure out why all of these saplings suddenly sprung up by accident or by just a fluke of nature. They believed it was just some bizarre phenomenon. And they were totally unaware of what this shepherd had done, his very selfless deeds as he walked along in the course of life. As we look at our lives are incredibly brief. It seems just yesterday that my two daughters were little children. The windows of opportunity in my life are becoming limited each day, as each day passes. Recently, I was thinking, when my life is over, will it have mattered how I lived? Will it have mattered that I lived? Solomon must have been contemplating that same thought when he thought of the years of his life as they began to accumulate. Listen to what he wrote in Proverbs 13, verse 22. A good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children. Now, he was speaking much more than about insurance policies and material possessions. He was talking about making a pledge to live life forward by paving a smooth road into the future for those who would come after him. Poet Ralph Waldo Emerson said it like this: to leave the world a bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden patch, or a redeemed social condition, to know that even one life has breathed easier because you have lived, that is to have succeeded. So the desire of every one of us as God's children should be to leave this world better than we found it. But it's so easy to look around at the size of the world and the vast amount of problems that there are, the sorrow, the suffering, the sin, and wonder, how can I ever do anything to make any significant difference, to make any real positive difference at all? Well, this evening, I just want to share some simple things that we can do to ensure that we all live a life that outlives us, that we live a life that is leaving something better for those who come behind us. One is to invest, and just find someone to invest in. Matthew chapter 6, verses 19-20, Jesus tells us about investing. He says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. These verses are a reminder to us that we're to use our possessions to glorify God. And these earthly investments that we make are not just to be to accumulate things. We are to invest in the lives of other people. How would you invest $1 million if you suddenly had that given to you? How would you invest that? In the property, real estate, a stock market? What would you do? Well, whatever you would do, you would want to get the best return on that investment. The long-term returns would be what you would focus on. Well, the greatest return is always found when we invest our lives for God's sake into those who will impact future generations. I often wonder, as Jesus looked at the children, many others ignored the kids. But Jesus said to allow the children to come unto him. You ever wonder what became of those children who sat at the feet of Jesus, who he touched and blessed them? I believe that their lives were much better, much different because of their brief encounter with Jesus Christ. Most of us are who we are, we're where we are, we're what we are in life because someone invested in us when we were young. Whether it was giving of their time, maybe some resources that they had, or just simply love, our dreams remained hopeful because somebody believed in us. And hope is a gift that we can give to others. Hope is something that we can invest in other people. We who've received hope certainly should be givers of hope to other people. So I want to encourage you to invest in someone's life. Invest in someone's life today. The second thing that we can do to make sure that our lives live beyond us is to instruct. Find someone to instruct. In Proverbs chapter 19, verse 21, or verse 20, Solomon wrote, "Listen to advice and accept instruction, and in the end, you will be wise." As we grow older, our lives should be able to offer a wealth of wisdom to others if we've been teachable along the way. Now, that doesn't imply that we are necessarily smarter, but it does mean that we've accumulated a lot of life experiences. And so the Lord won't waste any experiences that we face in life. We are to be teachable all along the way. Now, much of the wisdom in this world exists through some failed experience. You've heard of the School of Hard Knocks. How many of you are graduates of the School of Hard Knocks? Some of us are still enrolled in the School of Hard Knocks. Well, I prefer to learn from somebody else's mistakes than to make all those mistakes the hard way and learn from those things. But how sad it would be for us to hoard the knowledge that we have gained, the wisdom that we've gained, and deprive others of the insight that they need. So anyone who's anyone can attribute much of their success to having a great mentor, somebody who invested in their lives at some point, who inspired them, who instructed them in their lives. In 1 Samuel 9, we see that the prophet Samuel led a young Saul to the throne of the king of Israel. And just before he got there, he paused to give him a message from the Lord. So he instructed him. In Acts chapter 18, we read about Aquila and Priscilla, how they took a young Apollos aside and invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. Lois and Eunice, they taught Timothy the scripture since he was a young child. So all of these people instructed someone who was to come after them. St. Augustine wrote, "I learned most not from those who taught me, but from those who talked with me." Let me say that again. "I learned most not from those who taught me, but from those who talked with me." And so, if the next generation should fail, it will only be because we failed them, by leaving them to find their own way, by not instructing them in the ways of the Lord and instructing them in the godly wisdom that we have accumulated. A third thing we can do to make sure our legacy lives on beyond us is to inspire others. Inspire. Find somebody in whom you can inspire. In Titus chapter 2, verse 7, Paul gives this challenge to Titus. "In everything, set them an example by doing what is good." So the message is very clear. Live your life in such a manner that the young people looking up to you will find an inspiring example to imitate and to follow. Now, our generation is desperate for modern-day heroes of faith. Unfortunately, they get those modern-day heroes from all kinds of sources that aren't really good sources, but we need to leave them modern-day heroes of faith. So it encourages us to live a model character, lives that model character, lives that model consistency and courage, lives that can be looked up to rather than tripped over, lives that raise standards, not lower them. It is often said of great athletes that they made others around them better. John Knox said, "When I think of those who influence my life the most, I think not of the great, but of the good." So, when you receive a word of encouragement from someone that you honor and respect, it instills them a newfound confidence in you. They believe in you. They want to inspire you. Now, I'm not necessarily saying that will change the world, but it may change your world when somebody expresses encouragement and believes in you. And your words could change someone's world for the better. In Revelation chapter 14, verse 13, John wrote, "Then I heard a voice from heaven say, 'Write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on.' Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labor, for their deeds will follow them." Now that's a reminder to us that our lives are leaving a trail behind us. And so the question we must ask ourselves is, that trail that we're leaving, is it going to be beneficial to those who follow us? Tiny acorns are in your hand today. They have the potential to become massive shade trees down the roads for others and producing fruit and many benefits for those who follow. What will you do with those tiny acorns in your hands today? I encourage you to invest your life into others today. Find someone to whom you can invest. Instruct them in the wisdom that you've received over the years. Not that you're a know-it-all or that you have mastered all things, but you have learned things. Good lessons, bad lessons. But be willing to share that wisdom with others. And inspire someone. Let our words be words of encouragement, words of hope to someone else. Let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Father, thank you for those in our lives who've invested in us, who've instructed us in the ways of your ways, Father. Thank you for those who've inspired us to continue on. And let us have that same desire to leave behind a positive legacy that others can follow. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for joining with us again today. I invite you to check back at 9 a.m. each weekday morning on Facebook when I have a moment of good news. It's a brief 2 to 3 minutes of encouragement from God's Word. I'm David Somerville, pastor of Southside Southern Baptist Church in Parkersburg, West Virginia. Find someone to invest in today. Instruct them in the ways of the Lord. Inspire them to continue on. Leave behind a positive legacy. Amen.